start out and tell you how I first discovered Seattle parks. I was a military brat, and people don't believe it, but I lived 116 places and came here when I was 17. I had moved extensively. And when I came here, we stayed with another military family when we first arrived. And where did we go? We went to Ravenna Park. Thora Johnson, who was another military brat, and I would go down and sit on the steps down by the 20th Street Bridge. And I was absolutely in awe. There were such tall, wonderful trees, and it was so rustic that you felt you had gone out into the countryside in just no time at all. And that was my introduction to Seattle parks. It was also my introduction to Seattle people, because Thora told me about how peculiar everybody was and how they all dressed funny, which I would eventually find that I don't find them funny at all anymore. I mean, obviously I've lived here all that time since then, because my family left and I stayed behind to look at the wonderful parks. And I do think that parks are probably one of the very most important, maybe aside from libraries, that the city does for its citizens. I think that it's just absolutely astonishing that we have this system. It's a great system. It's, you know, the Olmsted brothers designed it, and we are just so fortunate to have that wonderful legacy. However, I will tell you that fast forward, and I became chair of Finance and Budget. That was one of my last committees at the council, and it was during the worst 4 years that we had in anybody's memory. We did not have receipts, and we had all these services that we had to provide. And we had to sit down, because cities can't not balance their budget. You've got to balance your budget. You can only spend what you've got. It isn't like the federal government where you can go into debt. And so you'd get down to trying to figure out what was the most important. And of course, we had to have police and fire, and we had to have human services, particularly at bad times. You need them even more than you do in good times. And when you have to decide, you only have so much money between, say, a health center, or mowing the grass at parks, or putting a new roof on a parks building, you obviously opt out for those things that are most important to the citizens, even though the parks were neglected. And they were neglected pretty badly. We figure we've got about $267 million in backlog. Things like roofs, things like restrooms, we just weren't able to supply those things. Now, fortunately, things are a little better. And there was a committee meeting to decide how we might heal this backlog and how we might supply a more dependable source for our parks. And the committee decided almost unanimously, I think there were maybe two or three votes that did not believe that what we really needed was a dedicated source of funds for the parks. That we had to have something that was sustainable and that was going to be not competing with some of those other things that the city provides. And so they came up with the idea of a Seattle Parks District. And that is what the proposal that is before us on the ballot in August. It would create this parks district. We would have the same Seattle City Council that you have any other time as the Parks District Board, and they would be making the decisions. Actually, Tacoma's had one of these parks districts now for about 100 years, and it works pretty well. It gives the parks an assured system of budget, and people down there like it greatly. And then actually, there are 16 other cities in our state that have parks districts. And I think that it might be, certainly we're going to debate it tonight, whether that's a good idea or not, but I think it's a tremendous idea. I think that it can come out from underneath the system of having to budget and and decide whether you want to have a shelter or you want, or whether you want a parks program. And we've got some wonderful parks programs in our city, and we're going to be able to do better if we have that assured source of funds. And I think that the City Council, which finally voted unanimously on it, to put it on the ballot, along with an agreement on how things would be spent. For instance, under the state law, each of the council members would be allowed a $10,000 addition to their salaries in order to serve as Parks Board. And already that has been taken away. Somebody decided that wasn't a good idea and we should put it in the agreement, which will be passed along with the Parks District. The Parks District measure, which is called Proposition 1, on the 5th of August. And it provides for such things as the fact that the parks, that they will be the same park system that we've got, and that will be the City Council members who will provide for the funding. And they've already decided how the funds would be spent for the first 6 years. So it's not something that you go into and 1 year it'll be one thing and the next year it will be the other. They tried to keep it at a minimum so that you would still have enough money to refurbish the parks, make them better, and also to take those places where we had not had the maintenance operations will then be taken care of. But it's not a lavish thing that is going to cost people a great deal more. As a matter of fact, it will cost exactly the same as it is now, except it will be an additional $4 a month, which in Seattle, we figure that's one latte or two lattes. I don't know. Depends on who you're going to for your coffee. It's not a great deal. But it's certainly, I think, for a city the size of Seattle, it's very important to have a vital park system. As we get more dense, as more people come, we need those parks more than ever. It's important to be able to do as my friend Thora and I did many years ago, be able to walk to Ravenna Park and see the trees and feel that outdoors sort of feeling that you get when you're in one of the Seattle parks. And actually, I really don't want to tell you a whole lot more. I'd be anxious to hear what you have to ask about your questions, and let's have some of those other presentations.
Great. Questions for Councilmember Godden?
So I've got a whole list of questions, but I'm wondering, in light of just starting questions, if it might not make more sense to hear the other two presentations, the for and against, and then open up the discussion?
Panel style.
I mean, I just think that might be, because part of what they might say would answer some of the questions that folks have, or might, you know, enlighten the questions more.
Okay, that sounds reasonable to me. And is everyone else in agreement that we can run this more like a panel than a presentation? Presenters, do you feel comfortable with that?
I'm cool with anything.
Let's do it. All right. Would you like to go next, Carol?
I think probably Carrie should is the yes side. That's usually the way they do it.
Yeah, that seems to be the way things often go. So, give you a little history. I think Councilmember Godden also started.
Please, Jean. I keep looking around.
Jean.
What is you're talking about?
Okay.
Jean.
I try to use the formal when I'm
it's okay, Carrie.
Addressing it.
Can I call you Terry or Mr. Holmes?
Oh, please. Terry is good. So I have been involved with parks officially for a number of years, but I started as a little leaguer when I was a little kid, and I pretty much concluded that parks were about the best place for me of anywhere. And so I spend a lot of my relaxation and recreation and vacation time going to parks locally and across the country. So they are my favorite places to be. My parks involvement started with youth sports. I coached soccer for a number of years. I coached baseball for some years. I helped administer programs to get ball fields all around the city. That was my real mission in terms of early entry into parks. We had not built a new ball field for 20 years, and it was time to get one going. So about 15 years ago, people and I got into that, and because Parks was responsive, we changed from having a real lack of fields to meet the demand, having many more. From youth sports, I went into I was appointed by the mayor to be on the park board. I served 9 years on the park board, and during that time, I served 8 years on the levy oversight committees. First the 2000 levy committee and then the 2008 levy committee. So I have a pretty deep understanding of how levies work as well as the budget for the department. At the beginning of my tenure in this, there was a lot of money. The city was growing, it was a boom. And we all know what happened in 2008. And as Jean mentioned, parks started to take the hit. There was less and less money every year. And overall, it was probably about a $25 million reduction in the amount of funds that would otherwise have come to the department to do its operations and maintenance. So that was quite a lesson. And I would say my motivation more than anything for being on in favor of this Proposition 1 is that having studied this very deeply, I am convinced that it is the best mechanism for offering a long-term sustainable answer to the funding of parks. Levies are short-term by their nature. This is an instrument that is a property tax. It is not a levy, and it has some benefits to that, in that it levies draw from one single pool. This takes this request for funds out of that single pool of levies, and it will not compete with levy funds for libraries and for other things that the citizens are interested in financing. I think this is a result of a very careful CL process. Having been on the board for as many years as I have, I think many of us moan when we hear the word CL process, but I personally am convinced that it's a very effective part of our democracy in the city. I see good ideas come and bad ideas come, and I see good ideas made better. And this particular proposal in front of you is a result of a year of very heavy process. The Citizens Committee that was brought together to do this was a group of people who weren't people like me, who have had what you might call a lot of inside and background. They were citizens who were very, active in the city, but they weren't necessarily parks pros. They were people who, I think, both the council and the mayor, when they made those appointments, were interested in getting a broad, objective, fresh set of eyes on the problems that parks faces. And so the committee was assigned with a couple of major requirements. The first one was actually looking at what parks needs. Before they decided to what the funding mechanism is, they spent the bulk of the time in this process that they went through working with park staff and identifying and prioritizing where monies would be spent, not at that time biasing this towards being a levy or an MPD, Metropolitan Park District. And what happened was that, as it has been my experience, is that all those, I think, open-minded people, the more they learn, the more they came to the conclusion that the park district really offered the best opportunity over the long number of years to take care of the park's funding issues. I think the other thing that's very important for voters to understand is, why are we here in terms of the cities having financial issues in the state of Washington? And probably the biggest single one that affects the long-term viability of the city revenues are the Iman initiatives. Now, the Iman initiatives essentially do limit the growth of monies that can come out of real estate taxes to 1% growth a year. And what that means is that when you have a recession, as we just had, your revenues are going down. As all of us know, I mean, who of us has had our costs go down along with that situation? So a structural deficit only means that in terms of the amount of money that comes out of the general fund of the city, which is the share that's distributed to the Parks Department for its part of its operating budget, that cannot grow at the rate of inflation. The general fund has only one way of growing, and that's when we're in a growing economy. When the economy is either flat or going down, every year we have a reduction in the general fund. So the advantage of a park district is an independent taxing authority. You can set it at a level, but that level actually has some latitude in growing. There was a recommendation by the mayor and then a recommendation by the council, and there's an ordinance that's been adapted, and if any of you really want to dig into the weeds, you can read the ordinance. But the ordinance provides for $48 million a year to go into to create dedicated funds that are exclusively for the use by parks. That's money that is not there right now. That we do have.
Could you repeat that, please? I'm sorry.
$48 million a year, and that amount of money then is applied to the list of priorities that was established by the committee, that was the Citizens Committee. The council did a very good job, I think an honest job, of adapting really most of the committee's recommendations. So if you have follow-up questions on the structural deficit, we can talk about those. But this is the one thing that can be done, and I think that we count on, well, let me say it this way. Right now, every year, there's a budget for every department in the city, parks being one of them.
26 of them.
Yeah. So the department itself and its finance people get together, and they come up with a budget, and then they go to the mayor, and then the mayor proposes that amount to the city council. City council's primary function, and if you look at their calendar, this is what you hire these people to listen to you and do follow your specific interests, but the lion's share of their hard work is about the budget. So what this particular instrument does is it will take a block of funds and grow the park's specific share, but it will still be administered by the city council. So in terms of mechanisms, what it means is they have a bigger budget. But the same elected people who are responsible to you will be managing that budget, just as they are now. Budget goes to them, they figure out the pluses and minuses, and they deliberate on it and make some final decisions. So the difference with this, the park district, is there will be a larger budget for them to work with, but it is still fits within their expertise more than anyone else to manage the final decisions as to where that money can go. That's really the biggest reason I'm in favor of this is that it will establish something that any other mechanism, maybe a parks levy, one, the first one I worked on is an 8-year levy, the second one was a 6-year levy. This is something that really, for my lifetime, the Parks Department will have funding to allow it to more fully utilize its facilities and provide the city citizens with what they really appreciate and want from their parks. So, welcome other questions.
Thank you, Terry. Carol?
Okay. I'm Carol Fisher. I am representing our Parks Forever. There's a reason for our name. It's the hour and the forever, because we want to keep some of the control with the citizens for major decisions about what will, where our money will go, how much our taxes will be. With the levy system, as you all know, what is on the ballot are specific projects with a specific amount and over a specific duration of time. And what the MPD does is take that away from us. And so we're really concerned about the voter rights in this instance. We totally, you know, maybe everybody else talk about themselves. I'll talk about myself. I have only been a citizen here since 2006. I moved here to take care of my granddaughter. And for those who have children and grandchildren, you know, you take them to the parks. That's how I was introduced to lifelong recreation also. And that, if you don't know, is the senior program in the Parks Department. I became very active in that. One of the things that I really enjoyed was taking my dog, my granddaughter, who I have to say, the first time I took her out, I had her in one of those front packs that you carry them in. I never used one before. This is embarrassing. When we got back, I realized I hadn't buckled it up the way I should have. She could have fallen out. But anyway, so one of the things we did was we went on walks with dogs, which is one of the lifelong recreation programs. It's a free program. And we go from neighborhood to neighborhood, and we see all of the parks. And that was a really great introduction as to what Seattle is and what the parks are and everything. I became very involved in all of the senior programs as a participant, and very quickly was asked to join the advisory council for senior programming, and I have been president for 3 years, and I was just renewed again. So I have the inside perspective of recreation from the standpoint of my involvement there and working very closely with the parks staff on programming. So, Jean, I said it. Jean mentioned there the two major reasons for where we are and the decisions we're trying to make are the fact that the current levy ends at the end of the year, and we do have a major maintenance backlog, and we recognize that. Those of us On the con side, we are parks advocates. We all have dedicated a lot of hours. I put in 100 hours in the first 2 months of this year as a volunteer. Don Harper, who is the chair, he has served on the oversight committee for one or two of the levies. Very active in Queen Anne on their district council and serves as chair for parks. So we didn't know each other a year ago. But both of us, out of our interest for parks, attended all of the legacy committee meetings. And both of us went in there with open minds. But we became more and more concerned about the metropolitan parks form of new government. So we decided that we felt it was important enough, and we felt passionate enough that we would actually take an active role and oppose the Metropolitan Parks District. As Terry mentioned, the Legacy Committee was created, and they did work. I went to all of the meetings with the exception of one. One of my concerns about the Legacy Committee process was the fact that they had three public meetings in January. There were, I believe, a couple hundred people who attended. I may be wrong, but the percentage is what is important. 81% of the folks who attended the public meetings voted against the MPD, and said they wanted a short, the majority of them, they all preferred a levy. The majority of those who preferred the levy preferred a short-term levy, 6 years, because they wanted to see things turned around within the MPD so that it would be acceptable. Unfortunately, there was never any discussion at the Legacy Committee meeting about the 81% who opposed the MPD, which I felt was very unfortunate, because I thought that was an important thing. If you're coming to the citizens, that the citizens' input and meeting like that, if they spent the time and the effort and the money to hold three meetings at the citizens, they should have at least recognized the results. The council spent 5 weeks deliberating, and they came up with the two ordinances, the one for the MPD and one for the ILA. The MPD is created by state statute. It's under an RCW, 3561. I believe the Tacoma was the first MPD. They're about one-third the size that we are. They are the largest MPD. The others are very, very small. And some of them are just set up for a swimming pool. So it's difficult to compare Seattle, our big, huge city, to these other MPDs. I just point that out as a point of fact. The original MPD statute stated that the governing board would be elected by the people, not a city council. 10 years ago, I believe, again, plus or minus a year or two, our city council went to the state, lobbied to allow the city council to serve as the parks district board. And that was, the statute was changed to allow that. The powers are granted by the state. That's the supreme ruling power, if you will. The regulations come down from the state. And those do state that the Metropolitan Parks District has the right to sell, commercialize, and privatize park assets. That's a bit of a concern for us. There are only a few things that the state statute actually allows us to vote on and therefore guarantee in this whole process. They are the name of the district, which will be Seattle, according to the Prop 1, Seattle Parks District. The boundaries, which are contiguous in this case to the boundaries of Seattle. The fact that there's a maximum of 75 cents per $1,000 per assessed value. And that in this case, the city council will serve as the board. Those are the only things that we're allowed to vote on. Those are the only things that are guaranteed by our vote. Why we oppose the MPD? As I said before, we feel that moving to the MPD strips the citizens of their rights to vote on levies periodically to say, number one, to endorse, we think you've done a good job on the last levy, and the citizens choose the priorities for what projects will be on the next levy through an extended process. It is put on the ballot, and we have a right to vote on that levy. The fact that it is permanent has its benefits and it has its problems. The problem is that if it doesn't work well, we as citizens cannot change it. We cannot repeal it. We can't vote it out. It is forever. So if we don't get it right the first time, we are really stuck. Now, there is a provision for citizens, I think it's 50% plus one of the those who voted in a general election can petition the city council to dissolve the MPD, which of course the city council would sit its members. I'm not saying the city council is the board, but the council members are the board of the MPD. So basically they would be dissolving themselves and deciding they did not want to do it anymore. They ultimately have a decision whether or not to continue or to dissolve. All we can do is recommend that we want them to consider dissolving it. With an MPD, we're getting further away from the democratic process of levies, and it becomes a centralized control in the city hall. Accountability is probably one of the biggest concerns that we have. There is a concern that there is a let me go back. You know, in Tacoma, there was an interview done by Channel 21 of the superintendent of the Tacoma Metropolitan, or Tacoma Parks District. And they asked the question, what do you attribute success to the Tacoma Parks District to? And his immediate answer was, we are voted by the public. We are a separate board. I don't know whether that's true or not, but that is what they felt to be true. So, and his comment was that there is no conflict of interest. We are voted in personally to serve solely in a capacity for parks. We are responsible to the voter for parks. Nothing else, just parks. And when we talk about, when we hear that the city council is accountable, yes, of course they are accountable. Yes, we can vote them out. I don't know about you, but I am not a single issue voter. If there were a separate parks board, then you could really look at, are you doing what we need in parks? And I feel passionate about parks. So there's also been a concern about oversight, citizen oversight. Well, if you stop and you think about the fact that the oversight committee is appointed by those that are going to be overseen, that give some concern. And all of these things that I'm mentioning are not in and of themselves a problem, you know, I mean, they are problematic, but when you start adding all of them up, that's what gives us a really uneasy feel about it. We believe that a permanent tax authority, this new district, is permanent, that it should be accompanied by permanent binding rules. Now, all of these things that I've mentioned, with the addition of the fact that we're concerned about moving general funds, depleting the general funds, decreasing the amount of general funds to the MPD, and the migration of funds that are listed in the priorities, such as moving money from key patches over to the waterfront park, that sort of thing. Those are concerning. All of these things have been addressed prior to, over the last 6 months, as concerns. And the Legacy Committee and the City Council listened to us. They did hear us. They did try to do something. Unfortunately, they can't do anything, or they, under state law, anything permanent, because again, you have only the things that by state law we're allowed to vote on. So they came up with the interlocal agreement, which is an agreement between the MPD. It's a contract, if you will. It's a contract between the MPD board and City Hall, which is basically a contract with themselves. It's not, if it were a separate board, it really would kind of have a little more weight. have been addressed, Oversight Committee, the general fund monies, the set of initiatives, they are all in the ILA, the interlocal agreement. And it sounds really good. We don't vote on it, but it sounds really good. And the city council has said that they will, and the mayor, that they will agree, or I guess it's the MPD, and the mayor will agree on it if we vote the MPD in. Item number 6.1 of the interlocal agreement reads, "This agreement may be terminated by either party upon the provision of 180 days calendar notice." Therefore, the MPD can be canceled, I mean the ILA can be canceled, can be terminated, can be changed before the MPD can even start collecting taxes. And I'm just going by, if you read the rules, this is the way it is, the black and white of it. No opinions here.
Could you repeat that again, please, for clarification?
The actual provision, let me read it.
What you just said is fine.
Okay. First off, what has not been mentioned is the fact that because of the timing of the ballot, which is August 5th, the MPD, if approved, cannot start collecting taxes until 2016. Okay. So, given the fact that the interlocal agreement can be changed or repealed or canceled within 100 days, technically, we could have no rules. We could have, I don't think the current council is going to do that. But remember, the MPD is permanent. We can't change that. Once we voted in, we've got it. I believe we need to think about the council in 20 years, the council in 40 years. Just because we have a council now that says they agree to this and they think it's a good idea, we don't know. And I think we believe we need the security of voting on the contents of the ILA, which would assure us that every 6 years the council would come back to us as people. We would have an opportunity to be involved and vote on things, not just a promise that is not guaranteed. So the two big things are it is permanent and it comes with no guarantee for how it's going to be run. We support parks. We love parks. We're willing to pay for parks. The idea is premature. It is not the what could have happened when we went to the state and got the ability to use the Seattle Council as the governing board. There also could have been provisions put into the state regulation that overcame the problems of not having any assurances of how this would run, of being able to vote on the amounts. Again, 75 cents, they can change. That right now, the plan is to go for about twice what we're paying now, but they can go up to four times, and they don't have to ask us. They don't have to come back to us. So we oppose the MPD because it's permanent, and it gives us the council and parks open-ended powers to set tax amounts, choose priorities, and decide how they're going to run it. As business people, we believe in accountability, and true accountability is not a set of promises that can be retracted in 180 days.
Thank you, Carol. I think what would be good to do now is just to let everyone have a turn asking questions. We'll go around the room. Just to make sure that everyone gets a chance to ask a question, and we can all kind of build on questions that are of particular interest to us. I'll give up my first question and make sure everyone else has a chance to ask theirs. If you could just limit yourself to one question or a short question and a quick follow-up, that'd be great. I just want to make sure that everyone has an opportunity. So, Pete, would you like to start?
Okay. So, I'll preface my comment by saying that I helped put together the 2008 Parks and Green Spaces Levy, served on the Citizens Oversight Committee, and chaired the committee for the last 4 years. One of the difficulties that I have with the MPD is I feel as though the City Council is, it's an end run around the levy lid, because City Council has other priorities that they want to use our levy, what little is left on the levy lid for. As you know, the mayor and council president came out earlier this week or late last week and said they want to provide preschool funding, which, you know, people, you know, why wasn't that handled in the families and education levy? Why isn't it handled by the state? You also have bridging the gap that's fixing to expire, that's going to come back to us, and they're going to be asking for a lot larger levy than what's presently expiring. There's a great possibility we're going to have a public safety levy to help pay for all of the DOJ consent decree expenses, and there's a couple of others that are brewing within different areas of the city. So just feel like, you know, we have that it's an end run by the City Council to not push the levy lid so that they can do these other items on there. So you're not only going to, if the council brings forward, you know, those levies, you're going to have the MPD. We're also going to be voting on the new transportation package. So between now and the end of the year, we're basically going to be asked to vote for three separate tax increases, all coming from different pots of money, but are all going to affect us the same. And, you know, asked this question at the CNC budget conference with Ben Noble, who's the budget guru from the city, and he agrees that the parks levy could not fit within the levy lid at the present time. And so I worry about that. I also worry about that if we have such a backlog on the asset management list, why is 40% of the dollars up front in the MPD going to develop new programming at our parks when we can't, now we can't pay for what we have now? And we're asking the voters to give the city more money to bring on more programming when we can't take care of what we got. And I got a whole list of things here, but I'll stop there.
Is that a question?
Well, my question is that, I mean, does the council realize what they're doing, and are they thinking about that?
Well, I don't know. I can only speak for myself, I suppose, but since we voted to put it on the ballot, I would say that probably the others feel about the same way that I do. I have found the levy system, as great as it's been, just is not good enough to get the kind of park system that I think that we deserve. And I do think that we have a backlog, and we are constrained. You're right, we're almost like in a straitjacket, put there by Tim Iman himself. We can only go up 1% per year, as you know. And since inflation has been running, even in bad times, at about 2%, that means that we're always going to have less. And this is an opportunity for us to have what I think we deserve.
But if we have $267 million, which I believe is the figure that comes from parks, we have $267 million on the asset management list, which is stuff that we need to fix. And we only spend 60% of what's generated by the MPD, we're never going to get to the point where we decrease that $267 million, because it's going to continue to grow. So we're not really solving the initial problem that the MPD was originally discussed to solve, are we?
Well, certainly not tomorrow, but I'm hoping that we make progress on it. I mean, it's sort of like our streets. Our streets are, as we know, are in shaped in places. And I think they figure that we are backlogged about $2 billion in the streets. This is only 267 million. Seems like a small figure when you're talking 2 billion. So what you have to do is you have to make progress with it. You can't possibly do it all in 1 year. And as a matter of fact, if the Proposition 1 passes, which I hope it will do, we will not collect any of that money until 16. Not next year. It's not because you pass it and then it comes in onto line in 2016. You're right, I'm sorry. Misspoke.
Could I respond to that also? So you're saying, I mean, only 60% is 27, right now proposal is $27,904,000 per year. That is considerably more than the current levy, which is used for maintenance and but not for maintenance, used for capital improvements and for buying new land and developing it. So I think I almost argued your point in inverse. You said that it wouldn't fit into the levy lid. So if we go to the levy model, there would
we
be
no, would with
we would
with like, the other
if
with
you,
the
if
other,
you just if with this instrument, just so people understand. What Pete's referring to is there's an aggregate amount of levy capacity that the city has. And that is for levies. The state statute allows this particular means of raising funds through taxation to not apply to that levy lid. So that means that it doesn't, the dollars that will come into this, which is for, as proposed, $48 million a year, will not compete with those funds. Now, if a smaller levy wouldn't fit within that money, in the current levy lid, I think it's logical to say that there would be less for making improvements on our backlog. At 27 million dollars a year, that's money we aren't spending right now. And if you take the fact that the dollars at face value, obviously new things will grow, that just by virtue of this, in 10 years, you will catch up. Now, there will be things added, but not at 10% a year. But if you don't do it, I mean, the bottom line here is if you don't do it, you don't have anything. Then you just don't have that $27 million to go after those problems. So.
Carol? I would like to say that we can do something. We can have a levy. We can vote down an MPD, and we can have a levy. The other thing is that I think it's interesting to note that initially the Parks Department came to the Legacy Committee and said that one of the possibilities that they were proposing was a $26.5 million levy that would have covered the backlog and then some other things. And their estimate and their prediction would have covered the backlog and a few other added things, like I think the other thing that was included was the backlog and the community's operating hours up again in the community centers. It was interesting to note and to watch week after week the initiatives increase. And I know that was an effort on the part of the Legacy Committee to respond to all of the people who came in and said, well, I want you know, this ball field, and I want this green space, and I want this, and I want this. And I have to admit, I am one of the people who said, if you want to know what we want and what I think we need equity for seniors. And they did recognize that, and they did put it in, and that is part of the $47.9 million. But I feel so strongly that the MPD is the wrong way to get that, and the wrong way for the Seattle to go until things can be turned around and things are guaranteed, and the operating
process of an MPD, I am willing to take a hit on my very own program.
I guess a general question. What I hear from Terry is that we're kind of losing our checks and balances as voters. I would just wonder on the pro side, what are the checks and balances that would be with it?
Well, actually, you would have to operate the same way that you do now in public. We don't do any of our business in private. We do it at committee meetings. People can watch us on Channel 9. Let's see, is it Channel? No.
21,
I'm sorry. Not Channel 9. That's another channel. You can watch us on 21, and as a matter of fact, it's all open. It's a matter of trust, I suppose. You elect people, and then you trust them to do what you want them to do. And I don't think that it's going to be any different if you have a park district, or if you just elect them for managing the budget in the first place, which, as Terry points out, is the most important thing that we do, is to allocate funds. This gives us an opportunity to have those funds available to us for parks. We don't have to compete with other initiatives within the city. We don't have to look and see we're going to close a shelter because we're going to mow lawns and take care of roofs and have senior programs, which I'm glad we do. Senior power. What we're talking about with the levy is that we've never, ever been able to really, really fund our parks, and particularly during tough times. The one thing about the Parks District is that we will not be supplanting the funds that we now have in the general fund for the parks. That is, they are kept the same as they always have been. The $89 million that we spend per year for parks is going to still be there, adjusted for inflation. So it doesn't supplant anything, which is good. And as I say, I really think that the problem that people are having is with trust. And I think when you realize that all of us are going to be running on the city council next year, every single one of us will be running in 2015, and it will be by district. And you will have somebody in your district who will be responsible to you. I think you'll probably have more responsibility than you have today.
Your question is about accountability, sorry. So one of the things, the model that has been, Pete and I and others have been involved with, is with the levies that has been, what we call it, has been designated as an oversight committee. This Parks District is set up in the same model as the levy committees have been. So there will be a citizen committee of, I believe, 15 members, appointed by, as the current oversight committees have been, by a combination of the mayor and city council. I would argue, Carol's inference, that those of us who have been appointed to a number of different positions we've formed on boards and commissions, that we are, in fact, have any allegiance or owe our appointing agencies anything. Frankly, in this city, if an appointing agency started to press you to get you to do what they wanted to, that would get out and it would look bad for them. I've served on these boards for many years, and I don't expect anybody who appointed me to call me on the phone and tell me what I should think. But that having been said, those boards, I will tell you with the levy oversight, I think Peter backed me up. I was on it for 8 years. There was maybe a handful of citizens who came in with complaints that were so strong that we really needed to take action on them because of a malfeasance, not malfeasance, but something they perceived to be a problem in the parks or the implementation of the program. It's open book, people can come, that will not change. And I don't think that at least if test is prologue, then I don't think we're going to see an uprising of people coming from the citizenry complaining vociferously to this oversight committee and trying to get things changed, because it just hasn't worked that way.
I want to point out one of the differences between MPD initiatives and what is listed in a levy. The levies that are presented to us that we vote on are specific projects for the most part. There is much less definition and detail in the initiatives that are being presented. So it's going to be more, whereas a levy, you can say, you did, you know, this has been done, this has not been done. It's kind of a gray area of what some of these initiatives are even supposed to cover. And that's a problem. You know, how can an oversight committee oversee those projects when they're really not defined? I also want to say, Jean, I'm sorry, but supplantation is in the ILA. The fact that that will not happen is in the ILA, and I go back to the fact that there is no guarantee that the 180-day agreement that you can change. Do I think you're going to change it? Again, I go back to, I don't think you're going to change it, but the MPD is permanent, and future councils, or even you, in 2 years, may decide that this is not working, we want to change it, and you can do it. You can do it. So if you see, and I recognize that, and that is a concern, if there's a major problem with funding the waterfront park, you know, money could be moved. If there's a major problem, you know, you really want the money to go to early childhood, you can supplant it if you just give 180 days notice.
We've been pretty clear in the interlocal agreement that that money is going to go for. I think it's as I think it is much compact as any levy has been. I think that people do consider that. Certainly, council members have been very, very careful to accede to the wishes of the people. I think about Initiative 42, for instance, which was passed by the people some years ago, which requires that any parkland taken for any other purpose by the city shall be replaced with other parkland. That could easily have been overturned by any council that ever wanted to do so. It only takes a vote. And it's never been overturned. It's because the people voted in, and I think that by voting this in, it'll be the same kind of trust that you will have. Well, I mean, I realize you could think of conspiracy theories, evil people being elected to the council. Imagine that. What would that mean? People who were liars who were elected to the council. I think that we'd be absolutely unmasked by the press. Tracy would be there looking at us. We have not only the, you know, voters who re-elect us, we hope, but we also have the press to expose any of our wrongdoings. And frankly, as I was a reporter, a got you item was a really good one.
All right. Tracy?
So I was really smart enough to ask a really good question. And I said with my apologies, I'm going to offer a comment. And that doesn't pertain specifically to the parks proposal, so I apologize. But it does propose to all of the proposals that Pete mentioned, because there's a lot this year. And I love about Seattle the fact that we will vote to tax ourselves for any public good, almost any public good. I've loved that since I've lived here. However, I'm very conscious of the fact that when I vote yes on everything, I'm voting people who live here in Delridge out of the city. Because, you know, regardless of whether they're property owners, they can't afford to live here. And it's hard for me. I mean, I want to live in the city, but I'm choosing to vote in a way that gets me a better city and them out. And I don't need your comment at all. It's just something that I think about when we talk about this stuff.
Okay. Thank you, Kirsten. Willard?
I
didn't even know the bully.
Yeah, I know. I guess in looking at this, you know, the debate seems to focus on how we want to hold the council accountable once they are in charge of this MPD. And so I just want to hear from the council member, what kind of reporting and what kind presentations will be made regularly to the citizens about how it's working, about what's being done, progress on the backlog, and all the issues for which this whole thing has been created, how effectively they're being addressed. And so what is your understanding as to the reporting back to the citizens going to happen?
Well, I presume it will work the way the Transportation Benefit District works. And I presume that when we sit as the board of the Metropolitan Parks District, if that should pass, if Proposition 1, and I sincerely hope it will, when we sit, that is the time that we will have the reporting back to people. That is what way we have done it with the Transportation Benefits District. We tell you, this is the money that you put into that district. This is how it was spent. I know that my Parks Committee, when we meet, we usually have a report each month from the Parks Chair or the Parks Superintendent tells us what has been going on with the parks, what's new, how we spent money, and what results we've had on those projects that we've been working on. So I presume it'll be the same way. And because we are public, we meet always in public. We don't do any business except in public. We'll be hearing that. I think that in some respects you may even have more control and more reporting, maybe even more than you want to know.
I think I could back that up a little bit also. The understanding is, I think the expectation of the committee that's been created is that they will be producing annual reports. One of the things that the levy committees do is they do periodic reports. The staff does a lot of the backup, and then the committee reviews it and tinkers with it and moves it through. So I think there will be an annual reporting. Another important part of the structure is that this year, this past year, there's been a full year of research done as to what will be proposed to get done in the coming 6 years. Part of the agreement is that every 6 years, just as part of the ordinance, as part of the understanding is that every 6 years, a group of citizens will be brought together, just as they are often brought together to create a new levy. And there will be a very long and involved process to hear what the citizens think of what happened in the past 6 years and form the priorities, just as we now have priorities of how this money would be spent in the coming 6 years. Every 6 years, there would be a full review by a group that will be formed at that time to then say, okay, we've done this very well, but you know, maybe the percentages of the allocations of the funds would be changed. I think there's perhaps a misperception that the council's going to start shifting the shells here on their own. I do think that the process of priorities will be very much less improvement.
I just got an announcement. I need to make an announcement. If you drive a Mazda and you park in the lot out here, your lights are on.
Was it a Ray's Mazda 5?
I just heard Mazda. I don't know.
I think my car would have talked to me if I left the lights on, but...
Most of them do these days.
But you know, I was so worked up about getting here.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you both.
Nothing for me.
I have a couple of questions directed at you, and possibly you would be both working on the levies historically. Is there any quantitative number you can apply to this as far as any potential cost savings from not going through this levy process repeatedly as opposed to formation of the district?
There's probably a pencil pusher who could answer that question. There is no question. I think it's sort of a no-brainer. There is a captured savings by going to something that you don't have to go through the whole levy renewal process.
But Terry, you just said that pretty much that process is outlined in the ILA, is going to be...
No, that's a separate thing. No, that's not running, and that's not running an election, and you and I know right now...
Okay, the election.
There's a cost of running an election, and it's not negligible.
No, it couldn't be. It costs $1 million to have a special election. Approximately, the city of Seattle.
Important number.
But it doesn't cost that much if you're putting multiple items on the ballots.
If there are multiple items.
You couldn't say, like, the one that we just had costs us $1 million.
Oftentimes, our levy elections, however, are the only ones on the ballot.
Quite frequently.
Frequently.
Then...
If you have other items on, then you share it with who put on the other items.
Well, I like cost sharing. And then the second part of the question is, within the funding, is there going to be any dollars earmarked for maintenance of our green belts, which not only are dismal, many of them are downright dangerous to the general public? I've seen millions of dollars for acquisition. I've never seen one dime from the Parks Department budget.
Okay, so I think that probably the largest single message that the committee got was that, as compared to any of the recent levies, that maintenance was the highest priority that the citizens had. So if you just look at the proportions, and there's everybody, I hope you pick up one of these.
There's a pie chart.
We got a pie chart.
Oh, wonderful.
And maintenance actually comes out to what, about 50%?
Well, the fix-it first applies to these capital projects that need to be done, and then there's specifically maintaining parks and facilities, and 8% of the $48 million will be an add-on to the current maintenance, directly maintenance that costs, and that is the department within the department that's been taking steady hits all along, and so specifically I can say that, you know, there's kind of these buffer amounts in there that are for expanding the maintenance budget. Sure. And so when there's more money, as an advocate myself, when there's more money, in the past, I'll give you an example. There was an area, this is years ago, where there was a space that had been used for mud soccer, but it was in terrible condition. There was enough money in the budget that the maintenance people said, okay, next fall, we're going to add 200 yards of soil, and we're going to level out that field in the fall and seed it, and the next year you're going to have a much better space. So I do think that, you know, part of what we're talking about here is that, you know, if we don't designate all the funds to go in every little specific column, then we don't have control. But in fact, we're paying our parks department to be parks professionals. And they are very, very attuned to their inventory. And if for example, I mean, I do a lot of trail hiking in Seattle, and I see the degradation, and volunteers have done, you know, a huge amount of work.
Oh, yes.
But at the same time, when there's just this extra buffer of money there, I think it's inevitable that all the ships are going to rise, and I don't think any one thing like green spaces is going to get shafted.
And I think if you go back and look at the expenditures that were made in the 2008 Parks and Green Spaces levy, there was a bucket of money that went to the Green Seattle Partnership for doing a lot of work in our green belts. And one of the things that the committee did was as other funds were freed up, we actually, I think, gave an extra $500,000, if I remember correctly, to the Green Seattle Partnership, so that they can continue the work that they're doing in the green belts.
And they've actually gotten a greater allocation in this than they expected. The Green Seattle Partnership right now is very much in support of this because it is very much to their benefit. There is an objective to try to get a lot of the invasives out of the city. Without real money, we aren't going to get there. This is a step in the right direction for that.
I fully concur.
So I think you were asking that maintenance, and I'm looking at it, it's like 8% is going to maintaining parks and facilities. And I have to admit, I'm ignorant on greenways versus green belts.
overlays, roads for travel, which are pedestrian friendly, green belts, large tracts of undeveloped land.
Okay, and so you were asking about
actually,
green belts.
Greenways aren't necessarily green.
No, the
ones are
But
you were asking about
green belts.
Green
belts, something
specific.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a question. Jean, I really appreciated hearing what you had to say as a young woman and being able to walk to the big trees in your neighborhood.
It was wonderful.
Yeah, and I've spoken with you a little bit before about the Seattle surplus substations, and because these are small green spaces in our neighborhoods, and they're meaningful to people in their neighborhoods because they're close, you don't have to get in a car to go to them. So, but Parks Department hasn't been recognizing that value. And in fact, as you leave tonight, if it's still light, you can go and see the beautiful wetland just down here at Delridge. After you go past the library, you take your first left, and it has mature trees on it. It's very pretty. So my question is, you know, with parks not recognizing this value, do you see a way that the Metropolitan Parks District can help us with acquisition?
Well, it's possible, although it's probable if the Parks Department doesn't think that they can use this area. I'm not sure that we can tell the Parks Department you have to use that area. Substations are usually very tiny. They're usually contaminated. In fact, almost invariably are they contaminated. It takes money to clean them up and get them into better condition. And if the Parks Department doesn't see a value in it, I'm not sure that we would be overruling them and say you have to see a value in this very small space that the Parks Department doesn't want. I don't see it as a possible solution. I do know that the Metropolitan Parks District can do very good things for us. I'm not sure it can do that. I know that you all are interested in it, and it's possible that there's some way that you can acquire it for a neighborhood facility once it's cleaned up. There's nothing we can do about it until it does get cleaned up, because you can't sell it, and you certainly can't invite people to go into a contaminated space.
Will there be additional acquisition money under the...
There probably will
district?
Be some acquisition money, although what we mostly felt was important to do was to take care of what we've got. And as you can see there, we have a lot. And also, we want to have people programs. We want to have those programs for the seniors. We want to have programs for kids. It seems like those are very, very important to us. And we have cut back on all of our community center hours, and here would be an opportunity to increase those. So I'm thinking that those are probably the sorts of things we're going to do. I wish I could tell you, yes, we're going to have all those spaces preserved for people. That would be very nice if there's some way that this can be done through some kind of a private nonprofit. That might be another way of doing it.
Well, I just want to thank you and remind you that being able to walk to places on the corner is very good for the neighborhood, the seniors, and the little children who don't want to get in cars and have to drive to a park.
This is good. This is a good reminder. Thank you.
Yes, and there is 24% of the budget that's been allocated is called Building for the Future. So that tells you that 75% of it is for other functions. But we're not giving up on the acquisition and basically one of the big things that this particular chunk of money is about is that in the most recent levy, particularly, there were a number of what we call land bank sites. So essentially, the Parks Department, that they didn't have funds for future, to develop them, and particularly they were afraid that if they developed them, they didn't have money to maintain them. So the theory is, in parks circles, is that in down times, you might be able to do some acquisitions and really get some gems for a good for the least amount of money. So that occurred. It has been occurring during this current levy. A number of those sites that are land banked, if this passes, will actually go into development. And so we'll actually turn what's now vacant lots into real parks.
Like 48th and Charleston.
Do you see room for land that doesn't fit in the gap analysis as a recreational park, but would be green space? Is there a green space type of component to the acquisition money?
There's always a contingent and a number of people who are interested in that. One of the functions that we had on the levy committee was reviewing opportunity fund requests. Every levy has had a cycle where people could come and for every we were able to award maybe out of 100 requests, we could award to 10 or 12 of those. So you've got competition. But I'll tell you, there's more positive energy in the room when you've got 100 people who want us to fix their park than about any room I've ever been in. and so, yes, you have competition, but I do think that the committees that help make those opportunity fund decisions try to be as balanced as they can, not only for, and the gap analysis always factors in, but there's equity issues, there's many factors that go into those decisions, but I believe there will be some opportunities in this for you.
Just as a preface, I think the MPD is a really great idea, just from the financial and share responsibility. It's like you want to go buy a house, you get a mortgage, or you can go down and take your credit cards and max them all out. Which is what we do with levies, basically. So I think it's a good financial way. My question about accountability, which I think is the big issue here, is that my concern is the way you structured the city council as the oversight is based on my experiences with specifically parks and Seattle City Light, providing information to city council members and the public, which is not properly vetted and is not particularly full. It's not a full accountability. So I would wonder how your ILA will be able to make sure that the public questions are handle truly in an independent manner as opposed to going to the parks people or the Seattle City Light people for the answers to questions about anything to do with this levy or anything else. So I think it's a great idea. I do have a question and I would like to know if you've got any thoughts on how you this will ensure that parks or whatever, don't tilt the information to city council or the commissions in a way that is not very transparent.
Well, I could answer that partially. I think one of the challenges, and this may be an indirect answer to your question. First of all, I got one direct answer is that we have a city council, you'll have this committee, but you also remain to have the Board of Park Commissioners, which I served on. It started with it when the cities was chartered, there was a Board of Park Commissioners. And I do think they're quite responsive to the public. And so you've got three shots at it. I think the other thing that is an option here is a change and is embedded in this, which I think many people, particularly people who sound like they're concerned about the finance part of it, just potentially as well, is that parks has been so strapped over the in recent years that they haven't been able to do really good there's specifically a chunk of money in this that we don't have, that's money we don't have in that, which has been really, is really being laser focused on doing the kind of analysis of, you know, how do you get the best performance out of a ball field in terms of the way you're maintaining it and the synthetics that you're putting on it? How do you optimize other aspects of your maintenance program to get more out of it? And so I think one of the things is this, that as part of the measure, there really is some significant analysis added so that I think there will be actually better data. And so, as I said, sort of an indirect answer, but I do think that then citizens will have that data. And I think that data can empower your ability to come back and call to question those things that you're seeing that maybe aren't being good.
Well, that's pretty encouraging, because the data is, yeah, that's been a very big problem.
For all of us who are involved with parks, we all wish we had more data, and I do think that, you know, in the absence of this new money, we're still in this, you know, people out of breath trying to run the marathon and not being able to keep up.
Also, I might say that you will have access, certainly, to council members. I look at my mail every couple days, make sure that I read all of the emails that we get, all of the once in a while we get a handwritten letter, and you will be surprised that sometimes one letter that you get, one email that you get, will be something that you can actually do something about, citizen complaints. And there also, as Terry points out, the Parks Board is also another place for complaining and directly complaining to the Parks Department, so that you really will have an opportunity, if you don't like the way things are going, to see if you can turn them around.
So this actually expands our grievance facility, ability to grievance.
I would say so. Yes.